Welcome aboard, folks, and welcome back to my regular viewers. My name is Rod. I'm a pilot with one of our nation's leading legacy carriers here in America, currently flying the Boeing 737 aircraft out of Atlanta, Georgia. And in today's video, we'll be talking about the fourth pillar of what makes a great pilot. This may come as a surprise to those who are not professionals in the industry. However, the fourth pillar and one of the most important principles or concepts for somebody to become a great pilot is fatigue management. As it turns out, over the years, countless accidents could have been mitigated, not occurred, had we known what we know today about fatigue management. As it turns out, the more tired you are, the more mistakes you make. That is called the inevitability of human error. You are guaranteed to make mistakes. So you need to be as best prepared as possible at the beginning of your day to commit the least amount of mistakes possible throughout the entire day. One very important factor to keep in mind, and I always do as I'm flying, is that flying is inherently dangerous. What makes it safe is somebody in the flight deck knowing exactly what they're doing. Fatigue can be defined as weariness from bodily or mental exertion, either physical or mental. And it can take place in many different ways throughout a day, in a regular working day of a pilot. A few examples of a physical stressors and fatigue that can develop throughout the day would be not drinking enough water to mitigate not going to the restroom, going up and down, having several flights a day where your body's experiencing altitude changes from sea level to 8,000 feet and back down and back up and back down. Circadian rhythms that are not stabilized as a byproduct of a fluctuating schedule. You'll fly early morning one day, the next day you fly late at night, or you come in late at night, you have one day off, and then the next day you have to wake up at 3:30 in the morning. Extreme temperatures, which is a big factor in smaller airplanes that either don't have air conditioning or the air conditioning is just simply not good enough. So there are many, many physical stressors associated. And while you're operating the aircraft, just one of the biggest ones is noise, the noise signature of the aircraft. How much noise you're dealing with has a tremendous impact into how tired you will be by the end of the day. That's where my headsets reviews come in. I do review several headsets, have reviewed, and will be reviewing more in the future to mitigate this huge stressor. Examples of mental fatigue would be things like significant events that are unscheduled, whether they are mechanical or weather or passenger or crew, an infinite amount of significant events can occur that are obviously unscheduled, unexpected, impacting the operation as a whole that you as the pilot have to manage. Operations in and out of very complicated airports that you are not very familiar with is a significant stressor as well. So as you can tell, throughout the entire day, there are many things that can really impact your level of stress throughout the day. Since fatigue can be divided into two different categories, both physical and mental, we do need strategies to mitigate both physical and mental stressors throughout the day. Now, they obviously varied in their nature. I do think that addressing physical stressors will allow for a better handling of the mental stressors. So basically, if your foundation is strong, you can then deal with the mental stressors to a much better degree. In order to mitigate physical stress throughout the day, I like to focus on four main areas. Number one, again, we're looking at this, if you reference back to my first video, from any utopic standpoint, right? What is the ideal that we're trying to achieve here? So, number one would be ideal health, a clean bill of health, ideal nutrition, ideal rest, and ideal workouts from a physical standpoint. So after you've taken care of your body, the mental stressors can be mitigated with focus on two different aspects or strategies, if you would. Number one would be keeping your emotional ducks in a row, keeping your emotions in check, and the other, having deep theoretical knowledge or technical knowledge and understanding of the task at hand, the job that you have to accomplish. In essence, the best way to manage physical stress is to be the healthiest that you can be. Easier said than done, of course. It is a very long-term strategy or program that will require strict adherence to good principles over a long duration of time in order for you to see positive changes in the right direction. So again, we're focusing on the ideal. By the way, this ties in greatly with our last video, the I'm Safe checklist in the pilot health assessment, which was the third pillar of our four-part series. Once you have been able to improve your health, and hopefully you've achieved what I like to call a clean bill of health, you can then start to really focus on the day-to-day operations, so to speak. Ideally, one very key process, a key step in this process, is to make sure that the stress from yesterday gets reset. You do not carry it over to the next day. The very best way to address that stress is through proper rest. Again, everybody's different and people need a different amount of rest depending on their activity, their age, body type. It is very individual. So you do have to get to know yourself in this process. I, for myself, I think I require a little bit above average type of good quality sleep. But if I have a really good workout and I'm, you know, getting back into shape, so to speak, I'll need 8 hours or more. On a normal day, I can deal with about 7 to 7.5 hours. And if I've been sleeping really well for several nights, I can definitely have a 6 or 5.5 hour sleep on one night and be 100% okay the next day. I cannot do that 2 or 3 days in a row. That will not work out. So having the ideal rest is super important, and I'm sure I'll create a video about this subject individually in the future on strategies to help you get that very best rest possible. But whatever works for you, let's make sure we're doing that so we're resetting that stress from day to day. Next in the process would definitely be ideal nutrition. Now, nutrition is a vastly complicated subject, one that I do thoroughly enjoy. I love it. I love the science behind it, not the fad diets and the stylish, cool, trendy diets, but rather key concepts, principles that have been true forever. And if you adhere to them, you'll be good. Eating healthy or being healthy is not a secret, and it's not complicated. It is really difficult to do on an emotional level on a day-to-day basis, depending on your relationship with food. So once you've addressed your health, your rest, your nutrition, obviously, you know, the next one, ideal workouts. And again, this is something that from the standpoint of management of stress and fatigue on the road, you need to keep it simple. For me, after being strapped to my seat, right? I'm not just seated. I have a 3-point harness or a 5-point harness, depending on the phase of flight. And I'm strapped to my seat and I'm flying 8 hours a day, sometime, many times. So I've been not moving all day. So my body is just eager to move. I yearn for that, you know, moving. So I need something that I know I will do it consistently, and I can adhere to it. So remember, a suboptimal plan that can be implemented frequently is better than an optimum plan that never gets implemented. Really key concept here that can be applied to basically everything in life. So I'll stick to it, and I'll be able to do that consistently. All those combined give me the best fighting chance at dealing with, mitigating, and releasing, alleviating stress that I can experience on the road. All right, so we have dealt with the physical stressors. Next, we must deal with the mental stressors. And as I said in the beginning, I do find it very important to first address the physical stressors so that when you show up to work, you have a clean bill of health, you're well rested, and you're ready to physically tackle a potentially maximum duty day, pushing the limits, and still handle all that the job throws at you. So once that is assured, we can then work on strategies to address mental stressors and fatigue. In order for us to prepare ourselves mentally for the day, it is very important to compartmentalize. We have to keep our emotional ducks in a row and lock up any ducks that may disrupt the operation. Very important concept. Be highly pragmatic about this process. Remember, our brains are hardwired in a manner which, due to a survival mechanism, your emotions are designed to overwhelm our logical selves, our capacity to think critically. So we must keep our emotions in check in order for us to be able to process complex thought. That is very important. So as we go about our day, we have to always keep our emotions in check. And lastly, would be ideal knowledge. Now, again, this does tie up with a previous video of mine. Take a look at it. The second pillar of our four-part series. As you can tell, these concepts are all beginning to intertwine as they should to collectively create the foundation. However, we're talking about ideal knowledge, technical knowledge, comfort in theoretical knowledge, so that through mastery of your craft to the very best of your ability, you will have the certainty in that knowledge that will give you the confidence necessary to keep your blood cool under stress and with many different whatever the operation throws at you. Now, that being said, it is important to keep in mind that ideal knowledge means something very different depending on who you are and what you're doing. Again, I do realize majority of people watching the videos are probably either wanting to learn about aviation, love aviation, or getting into aviation. So the technical knowledge that is necessary to fly Bush aircraft out of Alaska, those very cool videos that you can find online, relative to a pilot out of the Bahamas flying light twins, relative to a pilot flying the Boeing 777 aircraft, they're all profoundly different environments and they require equally different levels and types of technical knowledge, and they're not overlapping, mind you, to a great extent, right? Landing on a small lake shore in Alaska doesn't have anything to do with flying the Boeing 777, but both knowledges are critical to their operations. So do keep that in mind as I refer to this ideal knowledge is just to be mindful of your craft. Be dedicated to it. Flying is inherently dangerous. It is extremely dangerous to fly unless you know exactly what you're doing. Hence the reason why we're so safe today. You got two guys, gals, extremely dedicated, highly trained, upfront, who Well, as a rule, if you don't love the courier, you're not going to make it to keep everybody safe. All in all, folks, the primary objective of fatigue management is to ensure that you are fit for duty when you show up, whether it will be the first hour or the 16th hour or the 20th hour of flight, depending on what kind of flying you're doing. You must be equally fit and ready to deal with any type of emergency that may come your way, no matter when it happens. So as you can tell, this is a recurring theme in this four-part series. The primary objective is to be safe. You need to show up at your best so that you can be your best in live operations to get the job done. Get the mission done. That's the objective. That's what we signed up to do. And these pillars will certainly guide you in making sure you can do the job as best as you can. And that is it, folks. That is a wrap. This is the end of the fourth part of my four-part series, the very first series I'm doing on my channel. I do thank you for sharing your time with me. I hope you've enjoyed it. I have thoroughly enjoyed digging deeper into all of these principles and laying them out, hopefully in a manner that you found value and you can apply to your flying or your life as a whole, as this can truly be applicable to many technical, highly professional fields out there. And I do hope if you're a young aviation or you know somebody who is aspiring to be an aviator and learn to fly, share this video with them. This will give everybody great insight into the fundamentals and the things that you need to work on to truly excel in the profession as an aviator. I do thank you for sharing your time. It's been exciting. I've loved making it. We have just cracked 100 subscribers, which is awesome. So we will have a special video coming your way for the 100 subscriber celebration. A little bit of a different concept video, but you'll see it in the near future. Do thank you for your time, folks. As always, until next time, fly safe.